Hi, I'm Shabir Saftar, the Executive Director of the Partnership for Safe Medicines. We just finished in early March a 75-day comment period for the topic of Canadian drug importation here in America. There's over 1,200 comments that were filed, and the PSM research team read and absorbed all 1,200 plus. And so, unless you would like to do the same, which will take you hours, in the next 9 minutes, I can explain to you what actually happened during that comment period and what the implications are for where we go next. In case you don't know, by the way, the partnership is a 17-year-old not-for-profit that is comprised of all the healthcare supply chain participants from the medicine factory floor to the pharmacy shelf before you get your medicine. You can look us up at www.safemedicines.org. So many of us who were old enough to remember Schoolhouse Rock learned that Congress passes legislation and the president signs the bill into law. But that's not the end of the story. Some laws need to be implemented with regulations that govern exactly how that law interacts with the American public. And that's what has happened. Back in 2003, Congress passed the Medicare Modernization Act. And when the president signed it, it had two provisions. One went into effect immediately, which was to order the Health and Human Services Department to do an examination of the feasibility of Canadian drug importation. They did that study, found many safety issues that were of great concern, a doubt about whether it could ever save money, and unwillingness of the nation of Canada to participate. In fact, right after that report, Canadian legislatures introduced proposals to ban export of pharmaceuticals to America. So they were not too happy about it. The part that didn't actually take effect was a set of legal guidelines for doing importation, and they required regulations before they could be enacted. And so at the time, nobody enacted those regulations. Those limitations were actually very significant. They required that you only buy from licensed pharmacists and wholesalers in Canada, that you are not allowed to import biologic drugs, which includes insulin. And you were also required to keep extensive paperwork documenting the transactions and statistically sample and test for purity and degradations the medicine that you imported. And that medicine safety is a big deal. At the time, track and trace didn't exist, but it does now. And we'll come back to that later. So on December 23rd, they opened the comment period on regulations.gov. And on March 9th, it ended. And anyone in the country, or even the world, in fact, could file comments. What we found when we read the comments was that over 1,200 different people and organizations commented. There was a 20-to-1 ratio against importation in the comments. A very few of them were neutral. We found comments in opposition to importation in 49 of the 50 states. I don't know, Wyoming had something else going on during that time. Interestingly enough, and I'm not sure how often this actually happens, but many Canadians actually filed comments against the proposal. The idea being here that the Canadian community is not interested in helping us with giving us their drug supply, and they don't make their own medicine. So most of their medicine is imported. They can't get more of it. They're not a big customer in terms of buying medicine compared to the US, and they're one ninth their population. So one of the objections you've heard for years is that Canadians are not happy about this proposal. In fact, they have over 2,000 drugs in shortage right now, and they can't resolve those shortages easily because they don't make the medicine that they need to fill their shelves. This is sort of like when you went to Costco last week and there was no toilet paper. Someone came and bought it all before you got there. Same thing. Canadians are afraid that they won't be able to get medicine because someone else took it all, in this case, America. So 25 different Canadian patient groups filed opposition comments to the proposal of taking Canadian medications. The Canadian wholesalers, which ostensibly are the ones that we're supposed to be buying medicine from if this were to go through, also filed comments against it. And then Canadian pharmacists, doctors, and nurses associations also filed comments against it. In fact, not a single Canadian we could find filed comments in favor of it. These comments actually came from all 10 Canadian provinces and one of the territories to the north. So it was pretty broad in their opposition. Most shockingly, the Canadian government, the federal government, filed comments against it. They said that there was no way that their small population and drug supply could actually effectively reduce prices in America, but more importantly, that it was actually going to endanger Canadian patients because they just didn't have the drug supply to be able to make a difference for us. So that was, I've never seen that before, but that was pretty amazing. On our side of the border, everybody responsible for actually handling and manufacturing your medicine from the factory floor to the pharmacy shelf all filed comments against it. The manufacturers, the wholesalers, and seven different major national pharmacist associations. In addition, we actually saw pharmacist groups from 36 different states file comments or join comments against it. It was quite a showing. Conservative voices weighed in here as well, which I wasn't expecting. But many conservative think tanks and groups came to say that they were concerned that importing price-controlled medication from another country is like importing price controls. And if you have price controls, you don't have innovation. And that's bad for entrepreneurship. We do enjoy unprecedented access to some of the best medical technology in the world. So there's a really important point being made there by these organizations. It's worth it to you to read some of them. We also saw law enforcement weigh in on this topic as well. As you know from our tracking report that PSM has been doing for 4 years on counterfeit pills made with fentanyl, there have been counterfeit pills found in 49 states in America, and they've killed people with confirmed toxicology in 39 of those states. So it's a really dangerous issue right now, counterfeit medicines. And sheriffs are one of the law enforcement organizations on the front lines of actually seeing the human toll that those counterfeit pills take. Additionally, on the other side of the debate, you had advocates of importation file comments that said it's very difficult for them to save money importing Canadian medications under the current rules, and so that they would like to loosen them. The state of Colorado filed comments to this effect, but other states did as well. They actually said that they didn't want to be restricted just to buying wholesalers that bought directly from manufacturers, but they wanted to buy from all kinds of wholesalers. That, of course, opens the door to counterfeit medicines, and in fact, that's exactly how we got counterfeits in this country because of an unregulated wholesale market in Florida in the early 2000s. They also wanted to hide the names of the wholesalers and other supply chain entities that they were going to use in their proposed plan because they said it needed to be secret until the federal government approved it. And of course, that makes it impossible for citizen advocates and safety advocates to actually assess the safety of the vendors they've chosen, but perhaps that's why they wanted it. And additionally, they said they wanted to allow companies that were not FDA certified to do medicine testing. That seems like a bad idea. They also wanted to allow relabeling and repackaging and testing to occur in Canada. And that's a real problem. If you're familiar with the partnership's work, we've documented situations in previous cases where Canadians sold counterfeit cancer medication into America and then refused to come to court in America when they were summoned. And they were not even able to be extradited in some cases. And so this is a real problem. We can't have foreign actors on foreign soil conducting some of the most sensitive parts of any program like this. It's just not safe, and we can't actually hold their feet to the fire if they hurt Americans. Finally, they wanted to import some sensitive medications that were originally forbidden in the 2003 law, like biologics. This is because biologics are often very sensitive to motion and vibration, sunlight, and heat. So they have to be kept very, very carefully stored and transported. And they were afraid in the original framers of the law that what they were going to see was sensitive medications that were transported in such a way that they became not effective in the future. So there are three states that have actually submitted their proposed plans. Colorado, Florida, and Vermont have all submitted concept plans to the federal government, sometimes in advance of this rulemaking and sometimes as part of their comments. The problem here, of course, is that those plans, if you read them, don't have a lot of specifics. They actually ask for an exception to track and trace, which is hugely dangerous. They also don't explain how they're going to save money. They don't actually go into the cost of testing and how they're going to do testing and what it's going to cost and how they can save money if they do testing. Additionally, the drugs that they have named they want to import include drugs that have been in shortage in Canada. It seems impossible to imagine that we would actually take drugs off the shelves of Canadian pharmacies that Canadians need. But there you go. Some people think that's a good idea. Finally, where do we go now? So the agency that issued this is the FDA, but the FDA, HHS, and the White House are probably all reading the comments right now. And they have some choices, but no actual hard deadline for when to act on them. They could simply publish this rule. After addressing all the comments, they don't have to take suggestions that that was made, but they actually do have to address the comments. But they could then post the final rule exactly as they issued it the first time. They could modify the rule and then publish it, or they could withdraw the whole thing and tank the idea, or they could just sit on it. That's another option. They could just refuse to act on it. They could sit on it for, if there's, if it's the same White House for like 3 more years, if they wanted to. They could also re amend the rule and reissue it and try a new round of comments. Whatever happens, the Partnership for Safe Medicines will be following it, and we hope that you'll take a moment and look at it. You can find our coverage of this topic at www.safemedicines.org. For the partnership, I'm Shabir Safdar. Thank you.